Where's yours? Where's yours?
Logistics.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to all of you. Just a slight introduction. My name is Andrina, and I understand all of you are real estate agent. You already recently just gotten your license, so congratulations on you getting your license. So you will be entering into the market very soon to practice your real estate. So some of you might be doing sales, some of you might be doing rental. So today what I'm going to be covering is rental. Generally, tenants, how you screen tenant, how you screen your potential tenant, and then how to draft an LOI, which is letter of intent. Okay? So normally when we have a listing, okay, we will put up on Property Guru or different various media, even in newspapers, or sometime magazine to promote the listing that we have. That means the home or the unit that we are going to be selling or renting. So that when your customer, your potential tenant will call you, okay? So let's say for example, your potential call you, you cannot straight away say, KKN, no problem, I straight away bring you for a viewing. You should screen them before bringing them for a viewing. Why? Because that way, we'll cut short your time and to higher your chances of closing the deal. Okay? So how do you do a tenant screening? A lot of people say very, very difficult. Actually, it's not that difficult. There's a set of questions you can actually ask. So when they so don't be afraid to ask what your client wants. Okay? Ask very detailed questions. Like for example, Mr. Chan, why are you looking at to move out? Where are you currently staying? Why are you looking at to move out? So by answering this question, you will be able to know, oh, is he changing a job? Is he being kicked out by his current landlord? Or maybe he has some problem with his family, everyday fight one. So then you will know, this kind of tenant might not be so suitable for that unit. Because if he cannot even get along with his own parent, you think it's easier for you to get along with him? Because it's going to be at least 1 year you're going to be with him, collecting money, servicing his needs for rental. So far, any question?
But even if he wants, he wants to get to move out from my parents, had arguments, it's still revenue coming in. Why would you stop him?
Because you see, when you have this kind of tenant, if he has a lot of fight with his family, mm-hmm. Okay? Correct, you're right, there's revenue coming in. But what's the nature of the fight? He might have anger management problem. Then your home might be in the danger when you rent to such people.
Anger management, you can actually...
Because he will be, if he cannot get along with his parents, he might be fighting with a new neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
Then every day you have to go down and solve the problem. The landlord is not going
but
to...
But this might not be the case. There's money
there
to earn commissions.
That's why you have to screen them. Mm-hmm. That's why we say you have to screen them. After hearing this, then you'll take note. So when you see him personally, when you talk to him, then you'll get a feel how he is. You
but
have to screen them first.
I have so many years of experience here. I can talk to the person. I can pacify him. I can reason out with him. Why not?
Correct.
It doesn't really
at 3 a.m. in the morning. I myself personally have experienced before 3 a.m. in the morning and I'm more. Okay? Had a fight with the local resident auntie. So the local resident auntie was watering the plant at 2-3 a.m. Then this angmo said, oh, you're making my corridor very wet. But he did not pay for the corridor. So in the end, both of them were fighting on along the corridor at 3 a.m. Police came, and then police asked, who is your agent? Asked the landlord to come down. Landlord don't want to come down. The landlord asked who to come down? Yours truly. Me. At 3 a.m., can you choose not to go down? Can. I'm sleeping, I don't want to go down. Can. But then, 1 year later, the listing will not be yours because the landlord don't want you anymore. So in order to keep this listing, no choice, 3 a.m. go down. Then you waste 2 hours of your time trying to tell him this is a very small issue. Give and take. Yeah, you can resolve, no doubt. But is it worth that 2 hours of your sleep, 2 hours of your time? It could be very important, doing something very important, and then you just have to go away for somebody that's so stupid. Correct? Okay, come on, next one. You also can ask him, how long are you looking at to lease? Generally, our lease, we take a 1 year lease or a 2 year lease. I personally love them taking 2 year lease. 2 year lease, I get 1 month commission. 1 month of the rental. Okay? So, but right now, Singapore, we just recently changed the regulation. Okay? So, URA, the government say, oh, no problem. Now the minimum lease time is 3 months. Okay, that means your landlord can choose to agree to rent the unit to the tenant for 3 months. Okay, everybody can do that. But when I'm serving my landlord, I would suggest them not to do it. 3 months, too short of a period. Why would somebody want to rent for 3 months? Unless they got valid reason. Of course, if you got very good valid reason, I don't mind lah. Yeah, what I'm worried is they might be running away for how long. Yeah. Okay, next one. When is the move-in date? A responsible tenant will choose to look for a house 1 month before and not last minute. Okay, so that he has time to prepare the moving in, the looking for a house, and etc. So if somebody call you, say, hey, I'm looking for a house, I want to move in tomorrow. Can or not? Can. Even do paperwork, also need to rush. Everything need to rush. So in the end, this unit will have a lot of problem. Because the paperwork was rushed out, stamp duty was rushed out. Everything was rushed up, so you might miss something, and you don't know why he doesn't take. Why is he rushing? Cannot be 1 full month he has been looking for a house, then he didn't decide on. Then now suddenly tomorrow he wants to move in. If he say 1 week, I can understand. Tomorrow, I would think this person very suspicious. Okay. So next, I also need to know your client's budget. Ask him, what's your budget? Okay. You need to find out, this is very important, because cannot be his budget looking at to rent something like $1,800 per month, then you go and look for a rental of $18,000 per month. $18,000 and $1,800 is a big difference. Okay? Find what he can afford within his means. And next of all, you should also ask him, Mr. Tenant, what is your occupation? By asking this question, you'll know where is his work location, and also you can ask him, are you driving? You're working in Suntec, are you driving? If you're not driving, do you take MRT? Do you need to find a house that is very close to the MRT? Okay. And then also, if he say his job is a cleaner, then you also know that he cannot afford a rental of $5,000 lah. So, Mr. Tenant, how many people will be staying with you? Let's say he say, oh, I'm looking at to stay only 2 person. But Mr. Tenant, this house you're checking is 8 rooms, you know. Yeah, but I only got 2 persons staying. Would you want to rent the house to him? Won't you find it very suspicious? Why do you want to, a couple, 2 persons only? Why you want to rent a house with 8 rooms? What are you going to do with 8 rooms? So either they are looking to sublet the rooms to other people, or they might be doing illegal activities inside. Which later on, the problem will come back to you again. So these questions are very important. And just to take note, now by law, all units, condo private, only 6%. So let's say, for example, your tenant is renting this unit for his worker to stay, his staff to stay. You must remind him, only 6%. That means the number 7% if staying inside cannot get his work permit or the SP permit address. Registered.
But what happens if, let's say, like parents?
Parent can. Related one, cannot be non-related. That means one house 6%, okay? If you have 9%, all related can. Okay, but one house all not related, only 6%. This is to ensure non-overcrowding, because there's too many units, especially in Geylang, okay? One house, 1,200 square feet, about 3 bedroom, they have 20 over people staying inside. Have you seen a house with a 4-tier bed decker? We all know double deck, right? Imagine double deck, 4-tier, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you wake up, first thing you knock 8. Really, really. and it's very, very, very disgusting. So one room, they have 8 persons staying inside. And next to it, got speak stool and basically back to 1920s, very, very disgusting. Okay? Of course, you also need to know, who will be staying with you? Are you married? Do you have children? Why you need to ask if they have children? If they say they are married, next question you must ask is, do you have children? How old is your children? Because your unit that you're renting might not have window grills. So if they say, oh, my children 3 years old, then you say, then you need to remind your potential tenant that this unit might not be so suitable for you because this unit, unfortunately, we don't have window grills. So even you, then if they say, never mind, we can go for viewing first. Can, no problem. You all can bring him for viewing. During the viewing itself, again, you need to remind them, there is no window grills. Okay? So if the children fall off and die, not our issue. Okay? Most likely, this kind of people, they will ask, can you check the landlord whether I can install the window grills? Because I have come across. They themselves want to install the window grills, even they didn't buy the unit. Okay, you also need to ask whether got grandparents. If why must ask whether got grandparents or not? So that if your house got stairs, then you know it's not suitable for them. This will also help you not to waste your time to go all the way down there for viewing. Then you realize, alamak, got grandparents, got stairs. You can't even climb the stairs. This is a walk-up unit. No lift. Okay? Whether got school, tuition center, childcare center, whether do they cook? Do they need a fresh market or do they need NTUC nearby? This is a very important question to help you narrow down. Now, most of your unit that you are renting out, okay, the landlord will say, I don't want pets. I don't want people with pets. Okay, my house, I don't want pets. So you have to check with your tenant if they have any pets. If your potential tenant has pets, your landlord say, I don't want pets. How can we solve the issue? You can actually talk to your landlord and say, actually, pets is okay one. One pet is okay. Normally, people, cat, they take care. Your landlord will say, do one little got fleas, got smell. No problem, we can put in the inside the tenancy agreement, additional clause. Ask them to do pest control after they move out. That means flea bomb the house. That means, yeah, they get pest control to clean up the place, flea bomb. They call it the flea bomb because some of the landlord are worried that there might be fleas in the house. Okay, are there any special requirements? Are you looking at your house? Some of them, they'll tell you, I don't want number 4. I don't want my house to be 4th floor, number 44. I don't want it to be on lane 4. I don't want Geylang. I don't want this, I don't want that. So try to find out what their requirement is. So after you ask all these questions already, you also need to ask them, Mr. Tenant, do you have any question for me? Because after you ask so much questions, you must also allow them to talk. Ask them, do they have any question for you? Because by doing so, then the tenant will be satisfied. Okay, how is the rental like? What is the deposit like? How is the, is there any additional things I need to pay? So these are the things the tenant might want to find out. So do be patient and answer the question of your tenant. Okay? See, down here it shows, if you are representing a tenant, make sure you know your budget. See, the cartoon here shows, this is my dream house, I'm very nice. Everything is nice except the price. That means this agent has wasted his time going down. Right? So also when you're talking to your client, make sure what they give you is realistic. You see, we want a cozy, secluded 20-acre farm surrounded by hills, trees, and streams within walking distance of shops, restaurants, school, theatres, and hot night spot. Do you think this is feasible? Is it reachable? Are you all here? Can I get some response? Everybody sleeping? Okay? So this is definitely not a feasible one. Okay? It's not possible you get all the very nice mountain hills and stream and then you got a disco in the middle of it. If there is, let me know. I'll be the first one to rent it. Okay? Find something that is closest to what your client wants. Okay? Don't find something that they cannot take. Okay? After you have managed to find what your client wants, what is the next thing? The next thing will be our letter of intent. Okay? Mr. Tenant have said, oh, I decided I like this unit very, very much. okay? What I'm handling right now is a letter of intent, okay? A sample of it. So all of you can take a look. I explain to you in a moment how you draft, how you fill out the letter of intent. So for signing of the lease agreement, before that is always the letter of intent. Okay, so on your letter of intent, right, you will be able to see, okay, there's a date here written, okay, then there's a property known as, that means that is the property that you're going to rent, the tenant is going to rent, okay, so you then fill out the monthly rental and the lease period of how many months that they're going to lease. The booking deposit is a 1 month or 2 month deposit depending on how long that lease is. Normally, if it's a 2 year deposit, it's 2 months. 1 year deposit is 1 month. The 1 year lease is 1 month. Yes.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Can you skip LOI?
Cannot.
Why not?
Actually, not say cannot lah. You can skip the LOI and go straight to the tenancy agreement.
Yes. You can go there.
But with the LOI, right, you will be able to know the request of the landlord, of the tenant. Everything is written in black and white. Instead of the SMS, it could be, I want a fully furnished unit with a exceptionally beautiful koi pond right in front. Okay? And then with all this, it will be best, they give you a LOI, everything is written inside, then you show this to the landlord. Mr. Landlord, the tenant will request for a koi pond. The koi pond need to spend money to do, whether the landlord is willing or not. Okay? Why the landlord, why need a koi pond? The tenant have a $20,000 koi. Must have a koi pond. Very important. But spend a lot of money, but Mr. Landlord, your rental is $50,000. Do the math, most likely your landlord will be agreeable. Okay, before you drop out the LOI, also do check with the corporate agent if the person is representing the landlord or if you are also liaising with the landlord. Do check with him. This request, feasible enough. Feasible, then you can do the LOI. Okay, so what are the legal person? When I say here, make sure the tenant is a legal person to enter into the lease. What do I mean by legal person? Anybody? Any idea?
Above 18.
Sorry?
Above 18.
Preferably above 21. Yeah, we will prefer somebody above 21. Above 18 also can, but it will depend on your landlord whether they are okay with it. Like normally below 5,000, we don't mind. If it's something above 5,000, we will prefer somebody above 21. But then again, sometimes nowadays, you will get very, very, very rich, 16 years old, who want to rent something that's $7,000-$8,000. Trust me, they're mostly from China. I've myself faced before. No problem, you can also rent it to them, but ask them for their guardian. Their guardian will need to be there to help a witness of signing of the tenancy agreement. Okay? So like I said here, make sure you prepare an email, the LOI, to the tenant. Okay, before you get them to sign, okay, email them the copy. Let them read through first. Don't just bring a letter. Hey, Mr. Tenant, this one do already, sign lah. Why? What if what is written inside, he not happy? The deal might just burst like that. You email him, after he read through, then, oh, this one maybe I don't like. Then you all then can make amendments before meeting him in person. Because sometimes once you meet in person, anger breaks out, you is gone. Okay, so after the LOI is signed, once the LOI is signed by your tenant, you need to collect the deposit. Like I mentioned earlier, if it's a 2 year lease, it's a 2 month deposit. If it's a 1 year lease, it's a 1 month deposit. Collect the deposit and then bring it to the corporate agent or your landlord together with the LOI. Once they receive, then the other party can start doing the tenancy agreement. Make sure you explain the LOI clearly, okay? And make sure you also need to explain the deposit, the commission, and the stamp duty before signing the tenancy agreement. Anybody have any question about the deposit part, commission and stamp duty? I will assume all of you already know since you are currently already an agent, correct? So upon signing the tenancy agreement, and the CAA form, very important, that's your commission form. You must make sure that the party that you're representing must sign the CAA form. This is by law. If you don't sign it, CAA come back, invite you for coffee, I'm pretty sure you wouldn't like that. The coffee doesn't taste as good as Starbucks. Okay, once everything is done, remember to give a copy of your estate agency form, which is the CEA form, and the TA after everything is signed, and give it to your tenant. Yeah. Then the deal is closed, so good luck. So after that, you probably will already have decided a day to hand over the unit. Because like I mentioned earlier, cannot be today you rent, tomorrow you move in, mah. Correct? So while you're preparing all the tea and everything, there's another date set for handover. So for the day of handover, you also need to go through an inventory list. What is an inventory list? It's whatever that's in the house. The tenant might have requested it to be partial furnished or fully furnished. If it's a fully furnished, then the inventory list is very long. Fridge, washing machine, aircon, TV, hood, hob, hub, everything. You have to write inside. Then you have to take. Not only you have to take, you have to make sure you take a pictures of the whole unit. Okay, every single item to secure that 2 years later when your tenant returns the unit, you say, hey, is the corporate agent say, hey, see the tenant, the Mr. Tenant, the leg of the TV spoiled. When I give it to you, the TV leg is still there. Then you can show, hey, 2 years ago TV leg not there, I got picture proof to show. So it will help you in that sense. Okay? So that is all. So far we have already learned about the calling part where the tenant screening part. Mm-hmm. So right now let's try out, shall we? Let's do a little bit of role play and let's try out with each other to see whether you all, this is a script, okay, y'all can share, so both of you can share, and this one, you share with them, la. Okay, I'll role play with my colleague right now, Jane over here, to show you the proper way of how to do a tenant screening, okay, so Jin here is going to be the tenant, and I am the agent, which is the RBO of you lah. So,
okay.